I'd like to thank the Royal Africa Society, Facebook, Victoria and Albert Museum, and the Ghana 60 Years Old Committee for the organization of this event, which enables me to address, in my view, one of the most urgent issues of contemporary Africa. I know that today, and for the past week, the space for Africa in most people's minds in this country is probably occupied by events in Zimbabwe. My thoughts are also with the people of Zimbabwe, and I pray that we find a peaceful solution, resolution quickly, to the sad state of affairs. A resolution that will hopefully strengthen democracy there. For the moment, though, I will concentrate on the subject matter that has brought me here. I'd like to start this conversation with a few facts and figures we can all agree on. There are 54 countries on the continent of Africa. Apart from Ethiopia and Liberia, all the other countries were once colonies of European countries. All 54 of us are very keen and proud of our nation and how different we are. We see ourselves as Ghanaians, as Swazis, as Kenyans, as South Africans, and of course as Nigerians. In addition, we also see ourselves as Africans, which fuels the abiding dream of Pan-African unity. When we concentrate on our differences until we find ourselves outside the continent, then we discover that to the outside world too, we're also Africans. That is how they see us. When it comes to bad news, the outside world hardly sees any boundaries between the countries on our continent. A bomb might go off in Brussels, and it would not occur to anyone to cancel a planned trip to Amsterdam as a consequence. But an explosion in Mombasa would mean a travel advisory warning citizens against journeys to Kampala. A war in Liberia meant all the countries in West Africa being downgraded by the rating agencies. The outbreak of Ebola in Sierra Leone means Ghanaians arriving at airports in Europe and the United States get the special treatment. It takes much longer to shake off the bad reputation once acquired in Africa. Or to put it the other way, good news travels very slowly in and about Africa. That must be the only reason you do not know that it is now easier and faster to go through Kotoka Airport in Accra than to get through Heathrow Airport in London. Back in the year 2001, a former British Prime Minister said this, and I quote, "The state of Africa is a scar on the conscience of the world. But if the world as a community focused on we could heal it, and if we don't, it will become deeper and angrier," unquote. Tony Blair had no reason to say so. Our continent and its peoples were being defined by wars, instability, and grim poverty. The prescription he offered to heal the scar and prevent it from spreading sounded reasonable and doable. He proposed a deal between the developed and developing world based around the New African Initiative, the scarcely remembered NEPAD. On the side of the developed world, they would provide more aid untied to trade, write off debt, help with good governance and infrastructure, train our soldiers with the UN blessing in conflict resolution, encourage investment and access to their markets, and practice the free trade they were so fond of preaching. On the African side, Tony Blair said, the developed world would make sure that there would be true democracy, no tolerance of excuses for dictatorship, abuses of human rights, no tolerance of bad government, or the endemic corruption of some states. He said they would insist on proper commercial, legal, and financial systems in the African countries. That blueprint for Action, NEPA, was the latest incarnation of Africa's Marshall Plan. It ties trade, investment, and development to good governance and ending conflicts. In short, if African leaders run their countries well, then foreign aid and other incentives will follow. The timing of the speech, made at his party conference, a few weeks after the events of 9/11, made some suspect that his desire to help Africa was as much about Western self-interest as altruism. There was the fear that deepening poverty and disillusionment in Africa could provide a fertile breeding ground for a new generation of terrorists. Throughout the years, our continent has been called many names: dark, beleaguered, hapless, and hopeless, but some of the more frequent and colorful ones that can be repeated in decent company. And being labeled a scar on the conscience of the world sounded quite charitable. Some 60 years after that speech, it is obvious that we have not made much progress. Sometimes, to borrow a Ghanaian mode of speaking, it seems as if we take two steps forward and three steps backwards. We had a brief period of Africa rising, and I'm proud to say my country, Ghana, led that good news story as our economy made strides, and we appear to be getting out of the quagmire of poverty. There were around the continent a number of leaders who touted democratic credentials, and it looked like the good governance problems were finally being overcome. Today, the continent is back to being known for leaders who change constitutions to enable them to stay in office. Ghana was the first country in sub-Saharan Africa to gain her independence, and we've been celebrating the 60th anniversary of that happy event this year. We are painfully aware that we are nowhere near we should be. As the saying goes, if you have been doing something for a long time and not getting the desired results, you have to find a different way of doing it. After 60 years, it is obvious that the aid pass will not take Africa to where it has to be. We do not want to be a scar on anybody's conscience. We do not want to be pitied. We do not want to be either pawns or victims. And we certainly do not want headline writers to continue to compete to find the most lurid adjectives to describe our continent and its people. Africa no longer wants to be the deficit place to go to find the footage to illustrate famine stories. We no longer want to offer the justification for those who want to be rude and abusive about Africa and their peoples. It's time to build our economies that are not dependent on charity and handouts. We understand the aid fatigue phenomenon. We understand that donor populations want their governments to spend their aid budgets in their own countries. We have learned from long and bitter experience that no matter how generous the charity, we would, and indeed, we have remained poor. I spoke right at the beginning of this conversation about facts and figures on which we can all agree. Ours is a rich continent, has the world's second fastest economic growth rate, the world's fastest growing region for foreign direct investment, and in possession of nearly 30% of the Earth's remaining mineral resources. And yet, the masses of the African peoples remain poor. Let us look for a moment at a country right in the center of the continent, the Democratic Republic of Congo. Can there be, and is there a richer and better endowed country on this planet than the DRC? Every precious mineral the that humankind has been known to hanker after is in the DRC. Every mineral required to run the wheels of modern industry is in the DRC. Why is the DRC currently supplying the largest number of people seeking refugee status that arrive in the United States of America? Why is the DRC listed among the poorest nations of the world? Ghana, my own country, might not be quite as generously endowed as the DRC, but we are not poor either. We can, and we should be able to build a Ghana which looks to the use of our own resources and their proper management as a way to engineer social and economic growth in our country. We want to build an economy that looks past commodities to position our country in the global marketplace. Let me refer specifically to two commodities that are identified with Ghana, gold and cocoa. As you all know, Ghana used to be called the Gold Coast, and it was for good reason. We are endowed with lots of gold. The richest gold mine in the world is said to be in Ghana, Obuasi, and gold has been mined there officially for about a century and a half. There is something not right when Obuasi makes a few people very rich and remains poor itself. There is a set of statistics that I've been pulling out recently in almost every speech I make. Between Ghana and our neighbor Cote d'Ivoire, we produce 65% of the world's output of cocoa. The chocolate industry is a $100 billion industry. And we, who produce 65% of the cocoa, make less than $6 billion from the toil of our farms, i.e., barely 6% of the entire value chain of cocoa. This is not right. We need to change the statistics. If we simply ground and sow the cocoa in base form, instead of selling the cocoa beans, we double our earnings. In much the same way as we would double our earnings from gold, if we sold it refined, then it's raw state. We are determined to process these products. I do understand that there are nations who have built their industrial complex around the value chain of our raw commodities. It is time to transform that setup. It is time we were responsible for processing our own resources. It is time that we in Africa manage our resources well, generate past 20 years.